Hi, I'm Karah Priess, and this is Talk Nerdy to Me, the HuffPost science show in which we boldly go where scientists have gone before. As you probably know, cancer is among the leading causes of death worldwide. New cancer diagnoses are expected to rise 50% over current rates by 2030. It is likely that you or someone close to you has been affected by some form of cancer. But many of us would be hard-pressed to define the disease. Cancer is unneeded, error-ridden reproduction of cells, usually at much higher rates than is natural for a human cell. Imagine you photocopy a perfect report at work, and instead of one perfect copy, the machine spits out 3,000 copies, and they are all full of new, inexplicable typos. And you unplug the copier, and it still keeps copying. The consensus is that cancer will have no one-size-fits-all solution. One scientist explained that a promising therapy may be found in our own bodies.
There's been an absolutely dramatic change in how we treat cancer, but more importantly, how we conceptualize cancer. Cancer is a genetic disorder, not because you can pass it on to your children. The cells that acquire a mutation that is critical for the propagation of that cancer, that one mutation then generates a cascade of more mutations. Because one of the fundamental characteristics of a cancer, its ability to mutate. And some of these mistakes are beneficial for the cancer cell, and that cancer cell then takes advantage, an evolutionary advantage, over its sister cells and starts taking over the body. Cancer is an evolutionary disease. The survival of this silly cell in your body trumps your survival.
How was cancer treated in the past?
In the past, we were looking at cancer as a machine gone wild, a bus that is run amok. How do you stop that? You take a bazooka and you kill it. But now we're talking about smart war. We now understand the mechanism of this machine, why it's gone awry. And instead of blowing it up, we're actually pinpointing the attack on a particular mechanism. We'll flood it with certain gases that the carburetor won't work. Or we blow out its tires, but you don't kill everything that's inside of it. This is the major conceptual and technical change in cancer therapeutics. The principle of targeted therapeutics is you gotta know what's under the hood. Now, because of genomics, we're looking at the individual gene components that cause this bus to not do well.
What is genomics, and how does it relate to cancer?
The study of genetics is the study of genes, individual genes as they relate to outcomes, traits, height, eye color, so forth. The study of genomics is the study of all genes, all genetic components, even beyond the genes. Only about 1% of your genome is what we call the working coding region of your genome. The rest is really not junk. They're all the guidance systems of your genome.
How does understanding the genetics of both the human patient and the cancer help us?
What targeted therapeutic does is actually uses the variances of the different cancers to really focus and attack it in the most precise way to reduce collateral damage. Cancers look alike when you see it in an X-ray. What we've been able to do, however, is by using genomics, open up the cloak of a cancer to see its inner workings, to know that this cancer is really different from the next one by virtue of the entire blueprint of that cancer, and that's in its DNA. Once we started to look under the hood and look at the genes, we find that they're a whole lot different. We used to treat lung cancers all the same. Then we found out that squamous carcinomas and adenocarcinomas and small cell carcinomas actually behave differently and respond to different kinds of therapies.
All these treatments stem from the new understanding that we've garnered from mapping the human genome, a project that costs billions of dollars and more than 13 years of work.
I can't understand cancer, which is this terrible thing that kills individuals, without understanding the exact changes in the genetic material of that cancer. This complete microscopic understanding is what's going to give us the macro understanding of this difficult disease.
What is the newest frontier in cancer treatment?
The most exciting thing right now is that we have immunotherapeutics that marshal your cells against the cancer.
Why weren't our immune systems fighting cancer all along? We're pretty good with the common cold.
The difference about cancers is that as a cell, they're very, very smart. They actually evolve. they're genetically plastic. So they're like viruses that emerge in an epidemic because of mutations. What the immune system does to keep cancers in check, they do it in you right now. A cancer then learns to overcome your immune system by putting up decoys, by paralyzing your immune system.
How does immunotherapy work?
What the drug companies have done very effectively is develop molecules that releases that inhibition. It fundamentally disarms the cancer. So now your natural defenses can come and overcome the cancer. This immune response that people get nowadays with these new immunotherapeutics, it doesn't happen to all people. And in fact, it happens to a fraction of individuals. Some of those people who respond, respond so dramatically, almost as if they're cured of a previously completely incurable disorder. We've never heard of that before. Unfortunately, we don't see this happening to most of the people. So what we're really accruing is fantastic treatments for small segments of cancers. You chip away 5%, 5%, 5%, and pretty soon you've got a lot of cancers. They're being well treated or even cured.
What all of this means is that these developments in targeted therapies and immunotherapies hold a great deal of promise and will redefine what it means to cure cancer.